Let each candidate have the chance to do their final, why you should go vote for them. And so let's go on, continue on with the questions.
I'm gonna let Lisa come back, and so we'll go to the treasurer, tax collector. This question is for Diane Richards. What is your response to the article in the Trinity Journal?
I haven't read the article, sorry.
Yes, you haven't heard about it?
I just heard about it tonight, that there's an article. I have not read it.
If you have a question, we need to write it down, we can't have it open for them.
She doesn't read the journal.
Question for Diane Richards. Who was accused of theft and embezzlement?
I'm not at liberty to say.
Because there is.
That is McCarthyism. You accuse people and refuse to give names.
Excuse me, Mr. Ryder, we just not open for them. I have these as a brand, this is where they're coming out. For Diane Richards, you spent a lot of time pointing your perceived problems, but I'm pointing our perceived problems, but did not mention your qualifications for the job.
All right, I'd be happy to. I wish we had more time. I have operated and opened and operated many businesses. I have put American corporations throughout this hemisphere. I worked as a protege on World Security Fund, which basically does investments for American companies, protects them from confiscation, expropriation. I have worked for my family, who my grandfather made his fortune in the stock market. I can read law and I can do books. I can read books. I'm the person that actually found that the cop was done in secret on our courthouse. It was at 8.5%. I brought it up to the board. I said, how come that we have something like this that was done illegally? Those funds were dumped into the general fund, which is illegal. First of all, we should have already bought down that fund from 8.5%, which it is right now, to what it could be right now, 3 to 4%. We have been tearing on that. We need to do things. I bring it up to the board all the time. They say your 3 minutes is up. It's over. I do my work. I look at the law and what is available. What I've seen here is that the county is not following the law. For instance, we're supposed to have an oversight committee. There's no oversight committee for the treasurer's department. Why not? Why don't we have that? We're supposed to change our auditor, our external auditor, outside independent auditor, every year or every other year. Why don't we do that? These are red flags that you guys need to look at and think about. Thank you.
Thank you. Please state your highest level of education.
I have a bachelor's degree in accounting with an emphasis in business administration. I have credentialing through CSAC. I have entered into a fellowship program along with I'm working towards credentialing for teaching for higher level education, in addition to quite a bit of education specific to governmental operations and policies and investing and whatnot.
Well, Ms. Richards.
Same question.
Highest level of education.
I went to college, University of Miami, pre-med. I was in the president's honor roll, dean's list. I have certifications in several different industries, of which at that time that I was certified was one of 400, for instance. Whatever I can do, I always do my very best. There isn't any industry that I can't actually learn and be able to investigate and get to the bottom of this.
Thank you. Mr. Perez, what's your office's cash handling procedures? Are they in writing?
They are in writing, and we do that in conjunction with the auditor's office, and they're actually quite lengthy. We're actually in the process of updating those, but it's actually a book, so it's quite a bit. It's not just one simple page, so it's quite a bit. It's like several pages. It's a document, but it is in writing, yes.
Thank you. this is for both, please. Sorry, Mr. Reed. What is your knowledge of the tax collector's side?
Well, I haven't worked in that office. I know they do collect the taxes. I do know that they have upgraded to where you can pay, go online and see what your taxes and pay, which is really great because they had such reduced hours that you couldn't get in there to find out what your taxes are. I also know that their procedures of collecting the taxes, the cash payments, have issues because I've had many people come up to me and say that they paid cash and they're being billed for the same tax again. These complaints, again, red flags, something's going on in that office and we need to get to the bottom of it.
Good question.
Again, that is a false statement. There are no red flags. That is, does not take place. But we have five different types of taxes. So we collect transient occupancy tax. We collect the fees that are for the marijuana permit fees. We do lot line mobile homes. There's quite a bit of things that we do on the tax collection side, but there are no reports ever. There's multiple ways that people can report if there was some red flags or if they thought there was improper actions taking place. So those statements are untrue and false yet again.
Ms. Richards, would you find it a conflict should your daughter be elected also since the offices work so close together?
No, I don't believe it would be a conflict, and actually we would work very well. We know some of the deficiencies, for instance, where the county, the assessor is not assessing the corporations properly. They are assessing the people higher and the corporations at a low level. That's what the state audit came up with. These are things that we've discussed and we would like to correct.
Can I speak to that?
Yes.
That information comes from the Board of Equalization. That's not something that the assessor just picks something randomly. So the corporations like Verizon or some of the large utility companies, if you will, so that's not something that we just randomly pick and decide what we're going to charge them. So it's not something that the assessor just... In fact, it doesn't actually come from the assessor. It's something that goes directly to the auditor yet. So that's, again, another function that pertains to a different department. So those are different, not treasurer functions.
Ms. Richards, you neglected to state your qualifications. What makes you qualified to hold this office?
My skill in being able to read law and books to get through the smoke and mirrors that are occurring in this county. Why don't they let our books be open? Why don't they let citizens audit the books? Why are they using the same audit company year after year? If you look at the DMV, they embezzled, but everybody thought it was just okie dokie. Bell City, they embezzled millions and millions of dollars, and yet their audit was perfect every time. I can look through that. I'm going to bring in a forensic auditor from the Franchise Tax Board and as an employee that will be here so that we know that every dime is and where it went before as well. We're going to do a forensic audit if I get in.
Thank you. For both of you, why is there no longer a Treasury Oversight Committee that is open to the public?
I don't know. I've been asking that question. That's what we're supposed to have. It's supposed to be made up of approximately 12 members of the public, selected by supervisors, and I think you can weigh in as department heads as well. That's what you need, and why don't we have that? Again, another red flag.
Actually, my opponent is misinformed yet again. The Treasury Oversight Committee was something that we did have in place prior to the Orange County bankruptcy. So that is something that we had in place for many years. However, this is something that was subject to the Brown Act. We posted this. We invited those full participants that were interested in coming, and it was not heavily attended. And I stayed in contact with the full participants, the school districts, and those. and it was not heavily attended, and so there is an expense to that. And so the Treasury Oversight Committee is not meant to direct the Treasurer on how to do business. The Treasury Oversight Committee is meant as to provide an update and make you aware of what's going on with the Treasury, if there's potential things going on. For instance, we went through several mergers and things like that as far as banking, but it's not meant to direct them on how to do that. And if you're familiar with government code sections, you can look at that and see that it is not a required function anymore. So that would be an incorrect statement.
Thank you.
Yes.
Clerk, assessor, please. Aubrey, under what law allows the registrar to disallow people from being registered due to unacceptable address?
There is none. And our current office doing so is against the law, because you can live under a bridge and be registered to vote.
There is no law to say that you can't be registered to vote if you don't have an address. What we do require, and that is untrue, that we do not register people if they don't have a valid address. What we do is we reach out to the voters to get a valid address so that we can precinct them correctly, so that then when they do get their ballot, they can vote on the races they're eligible to vote on.
Right.
Say
that question again.
Under what law allows the registrar to disallow people from being registered due to unacceptable address?
Yeah, I'm not aware of any law that allows that to happen. That shouldn't be happening.
Okay. Is there a conflict of interest with mother and daughter running in office so close together?
Well, I think for some people that could be a problem, but I cannot be budged from my ballots. So I may not be the loudest person, but if you're telling me to do something wrong, and I won't do it. If I know it's wrong, it's not going to happen. So, no.
For all three, please. Why are observers not allowed to view signature verification like all other counties and cities?
They should be. That's that is the law. That's an election code requirement. I can find the election code. Public observers is election code 15272. That was actually cited by the grand jury as not occurring in our county at the 2016 election that they observed. So it is a requirement that you're allowed, observers are allowed to view signature verification.
So observers are allowed to view the signature verification process. They are not allowed to view the signatures and the personal information of the voters. And that's something I will keep confidential. Nobody will see your signature or your address or your driver's license number. I will continue to keep that confidential. And observers do get to see the process, though, for sure. Thank you.
Well, my personal experience with this current elections office is that you get to view either through a window or from about 20 feet away behind a room. And that's not the way the law is set up to allow you to observe elections. The grand jury report included a picture that showed people observing the elections process directly over the shoulder of those who were verifying the signatures. And that's the way it should be.
Very
good.
Thank you. There are other county elections officials that do allow someone to look over the shoulder and see the confidential information of a voter. That is something I will not do. Your information will be kept confidential as long as I'm the registrar of voters.
Yes! The only thing that's required that is secret about a ballot is your choice. It's required by law that observation is allowed, including the signatures. It's required by the law. There's actually no protection even for your name, address, etc. There are several election codes. It's called the Street Index. And during the voting process, the voting officials are required to, every hour, post a list of who's voted, their names and addresses, and who's crossed off, so that people can go out and encourage other people to vote. That is the law. Very simple.
Okay. For all three, please. We're all writing votes counted in the 2016 presidential election, and will they be counted in future elections?
I'm sorry, was it all write-in votes?
Were all write-in votes counted in the 2016 presidential election?
There were no qualified write-ins for the 2016 election. And so if there are qualified write-ins for this current election, I'm sure that the person running the election will actually count those, if there's a qualified write-in.
I actually had several people approach me and say that they wrote in candidates, and you are allowed to do that, and they should be counted and accounted for properly, because you have a right to vote for whomever you choose, not just who's on the ballot.
There is a process for write-in candidates, and it is true that there were no qualified write-in candidates during the 2016 presidential election. There actually may have been one in the November election, but I'm not quite sure. I don't remember. It's been 2 years. Those votes do actually need to be accounted for. So if someone wrote a write-in, it needs to say write-in on the tally, the final tally. It needs to say that there were write-in votes. But if none of those write-ins were eligible, then you don't actually have to say who those write-ins were for.
Carl, please. What high school did you graduate from? In what year? And what college have you? What college have you finished?
I'll take this one because I'm sure it's addressed to me. I graduated from Trinity Alpsview High School in 1992, and I've had some college courses through Shasta College.
Okay. I was homeschooled, so I graduated from the school of Keeney. And I graduated, technically I started taking college courses when I was 17, so I guess I graduated when I was 17. And I've had some college courses, but they weren't going in the way that I felt my life was going, so I stopped doing those and went on with my life.
I graduated from Washington High School in Sioux Falls, South Dakota in 1981. I went on to a bachelor's degree in political science and French, and then a master's degree in public administration. I've also had some additional courses towards a master's in business administration as well.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Wright. Right. What do you feel you can do to make Trinity County a better place to live?
Well, that's why I'm running for office. I feel like you need a clear choice this election, and by having and ensuring free and fair elections, as well as the protection of private property and ethical taxation, I believe that you will have a better life. You'll know that you're being properly represented because you have confidence that your vote is accurately being counted, and there's no questions about the procedures in the elections.
Thank you. For all three, please, what is your view of public observation in elections? What is your view of public observation in elections?
Exactly how we allow public observation is we have a window. It's 4x8 that observers are more than welcome to come in and watch the processes.
I am all for public observation. I am a trained election integrity observer. I did that for two election cycles. I think that if it was done properly, it could be a fantastic time that people would just be lined up to participate, because the more participation you get, the better for our republic.
We did cover this a bit. I'm a strong advocate, of course, for following the law, which does require public observation. I don't think it should be behind a little window where shades get pulled up. It shouldn't be behind 12 feet behind in a cordon area rope. You should be able to observe openly and participate in the process. That's really part of the foundation of our government, is to allow for public participation, which would include public observation through all phases of the election other than what vote you cast inside the
Has everyone answered that question? There's a lot of questions here. Thank you. For all three, please. How is timber taxed in this county, and how should TPZ lands be monitored for compliance with zone requirements? Ms. Keene.
I don't think that the assessor's office monitors compliance with zoning. I think that's a function of the planning department. I would hope that they're just being assessed according to the law, but I don't think it's being done quite perfectly, but I would have to get into the office to make sure that it's being done right, and if there's anything I can do to fix it, let's rephrase that. If I'm elected and there was something being done wrong, I would make it a priority.
Mr. Ward.
How
is timber taxed in this county, and how should TPZ lands be monitored for compliance with zone requirements?
Timber tax is based on the quality of the soil and the trees that are grown. And there's codes, RMT codes, revenue taxation codes, and Gable Street is to assess those properties.
Mrs. Wright, what qualifications do you have to run for this position?
Well, I've gone over my qualifications quite a bit. I can go over those again if you'd like. So I have a bachelor's degree in political science and French. I have a master's degree in public administration, which is really the highest level education around management of government offices. I was in the federal government in a presidential management program with the U.S. Justice Department and the Executive Office of U.S. Trustees, where I assisted the controller in really developing the financial mechanism for self-funding. We also had investment authority, and we rolled this out to a nationwide entity, the U.S. Trustees, that opened up offices across the country. So that's some of my formal public sector experience. I also worked in the public sector, a nonprofit at a college as a controller. I was also the executive director of a chamber of commerce and executive director of Economic Development Corporation, which probably is the closest in terms of the assessment portion, where we really work though instead of. Happy to discuss further with anybody who would like to know more about my qualifications.
Thank you. For all three, please. Has your assessment on your own house gone down in the past 10 years? If so, how?
No, my assessment has not gone down. My assessment goes up annually, just like anybody else's. Your property tax assessments, you have your base year value, which is the value that it was when you had a reappraisable transaction. And then it is inflated annually by the factor value issued by the Board of Equalization. Mine has not gone down, it has gone up.
Mrs. Bright.
Mine has not gone down either. It's actually gone up in the past 10 years, probably about 30%, which I think is a little bit out of skew. My income has gone up 30%, but it has not gone down.
I don't actually own property in Cherokee County. I live on my family's ranch. However, I can tell you that no, my family's property taxes have not gone down. They've gone up. As there is a certain amount that they are allowed to go up, but there you go.
Mr. Wright, how would you enforce the cannabis laws, i.e. no grow zones?
The Clerk of Voter Assessor does not enforce any laws, so I wouldn't be involved with that.
Thank you. For all three, please. Explain your understanding of privacy protection in elections.
Well, most of what you write down on your affidavit to register to vote is actually public. Things like your social security and your license number are not public as far as I know. But that signature is actually posted at the polling places, and it's supposed to be posted at the elections office as well, because it is technically a place where you can go and vote. So your signature, sorry guys, is not private. There is actually, I believe there is actually a program for people to have their information protected if they are endangered people. So if you're being protected by authorities from, say, an abusive ex, I believe that that gives you that option. But almost everything else is public.
This is right.
Oh, yeah.
Privacy protection.
Yeah, we talked a bit about the privacy of yours. It's really the actual ballot that you cast, the selections you make. That's really the limitation on your privacy protection. I wasn't aware of the abusive protection, but that's a good additional protection that I would support as well.
What?
I'm going to have to disagree with both of my opponents. Your voter registration information is not public information. So that is very important to me to keep private. I'll touch on the confidential voters that Ms. Keeney is referring to. There is a confidential voter system that the state of California has, and it's not only for your individuals that have a, you know, they're being domestic violence or threatened for something. There's also a program for law enforcement officers also to be confidential voters.
I heard about that as well. I think we already covered this. There's actually four different election codes that require that the voter name as well as their address be posted every hour during the election process. So that means your voter registration information is posted. It's available for public viewing. Your name is crossed off. So that that registration information is not.
Thank you. This is for Mrs. Bright and Ms. Keeney. What is your current employment? If elected, will you continue this employment? Mrs. Bright.
I have a few different things that I work on in a self-employed way. No, I would not continue those particular ventures. I would focus my efforts full-time.
I currently manage my family's ranch in Hayfork. I also manage our mining ventures in all over Trinity County. We and our family love to go around and dig. This job will be a full-time job, so I'll go home maybe on the weekends. I'll probably have to move to Weaverville in order to be able to put everything into this job as I would need to. But like I said, I might go home on the weekends, help out with stuff, but I'm going to have to become a Weaverville.
This is for all three, please. Comments on Proposition 39 bond measure requirements, Mrs. Wallace.
What's the question?
Comment on Proposition 39 bond measure requirements is what it says.
So maybe I'm just going to read into the question because I don't really know if it is a question. In November, there was a ballot measure put on the put on the ballot for the Mountain Valley Joint Unified School District to fix mold issues in their school. That passed with flying colors. There's currently a lawsuit by Mr. Weir against me that is holding up that bond measure. It goes back to court later in May, and hopefully the court case will be dismissed because there's no merit to it.
I have personally nothing to do with that whole rigmarole right now. But I do believe that it was illegally placed on our ballot, and that it should have been placed on a different election, but that's all I have to say about that.
Proposition 39 was actually passed by the voters of the state of California, and what it allows for is a lower threshold to pass bond measures. Previous requirements of the law were for 67%, supermajority, they call it 67% passage. Proposition 39 allows for 55%, but there are additional certain requirements that need to be met, including two-thirds of the governing board of a school district or the community college district has to approve it to go on the ballot. The bond proposal must be included on a statewide primary or a general election or a regularly scheduled local election or statewide election. And then there's some tax rate requirements as well. So Proposition 39 is really about the addition of the 55%, but then the additional requirements. And it's important that those go on to general election or local scheduled elections.
Thank you.
So I'll rebut that. November 2017 was a general election for the local school districts and special districts.
For all three, please. Would you work side by side with your staff or only be a department figurehead? Mrs. Wright.
Absolutely. I believe in teamwork. It's going to take a lot to go through and make the improvements needed in this office, so I'll be working side by side to get things fixed.
I do work side by side with my staff, and I have an excellent staff with great customer service skills, are very knowledgeable and honest people, and so I don't think any of these things fix for you.
Absolutely. Trinity County is too small of a county to be a figurehead when you're in an office, in a public office. So, you know, there are quite a few things that I feel need to be fixed, and most of this has to do with record keeping in the office, and that will require teamwork from the staff and lots of nose to the grindstone work for myself, so.
For all three, please. How will you ensure ballots are safeguarded and do not, and are not tampered with?
So ballots are safeguarded. We have, it's a control. Two people are always with a ballot. Two people go to the post office to check the mail. Two people go to the post office to drop ballots off. When ballots are being counted or in the office, there's only two people. They're locked up. There is, the doors are locked and in locked cabinets.
Thank you, Ms. Wright.
So the secure storage of our ballots is very critical. There have been questions brought up by the grand jury. There are multiple keys that are distributed to courthouse employees that do have access to where the ballots were stored in the last election. Those that needs to be better controlled. I would advocate for moving the election counting process back to the basement where there's more of a central, a single, you know, point of access. As it stands currently as well, the ballots are actually stored in an area that can be accessed by two of the offices, adjoining offices, so they aren't really as secure as they should be by law. And that's very important because there has been questions about whether ballots have gone missing at times, and that's nothing that we can tolerate in this democracy.
I have to agree with Lisa on this, but I would also like to add an additional point that I would advocate for a closed-circuit TV in the elections office where the ballots are being stored and counted so that 24-hour surveillance would occur, and that way anybody that feels the need can sit at their TV or their computer and watch so that we are better protected.
Mrs. White, has this ever happened while you were working for the county on my campus? Tampering?
I'm sorry, has tampering ever happened while I worked for the county? Tampering with?
You're talking about ballot safeguards.
I am not aware of any tampering of ballots under my leadership.
I'm holding my hand for the last question. For all three, please, what are the functions of the clerk, recorder, assessor's office? Please, Mrs. White.
So the functions of the clerk, recorder, assessor's office. So the clerk's office is the office we're using the certified model of your birth, death, and marriage certificates. You also purchase your marriage license in the clerk's office. The recorder's office functions as recording all documents to put them on public record for public information. The assessor's office assesses all real and personal property within.
Well, she said most of it, but if you want, I can read you the exact description of all three offices from Trinity County's website.
No,
and that,
no.
You okay?
I know. What did you say?
Do what you wish.
You don't want me to, it's okay. It's what we got.
Right.
I
have nothing to add then. Thank you. You are welcome. We're scheduled to have each of the candidates now.
now give us a short reason why we should vote for it. Brevity is appreciated, because I think we're all tired. Probably all want to go home. Start over here with Terry.
Thank you again for this opportunity. I've absolutely appreciated the privilege of serving as your treasurer tax collector since 2009. It's been an incredible experience serving the constituents of Trinity County. The responsibilities of treasurer tax collector are established by laws, codes, and county ordinances. As an elected official, I have fiduciary responsibilities. My obligations are to collect, protect, and invest the vital revenues of the county. I have a wonderful team that works hard and continually strives to ensure the best overall experience for our community members. I truly appreciate their attitudes, ethics, and service. As treasurer, I'm also in charge of our capital reserves, which means balancing the needs of our various constituents with the guidelines of our policies, as well as the state codes. Safety, liquidity, and return are within the cash flow restraints of our county, and other depositors are my mandate. Additionally, I serve as a depository performing cash mandate management functions for all funds belonging to the county schools and special districts. As tax collector, I administer the billing, the collection and reporting functions of property tax revenues levied. I ensure proper internal controls to perform accounting and fiscal record keeping duties in the collection of taxes. We serve as a check and balance for the other departments. We've weathered the worst recession since the 1920s. Our rate of return on our investment pools is as high or higher than 3/4 of the California counties. Our portfolio does not have risk or credit concerns. We are currently in the process now to refinance the debt to provide the county with significant savings. I believe openness, accountability, and honesty are what defines government transparency. Transparency is not an option, it is a requirement by law. I am committed to fulfilling my legal obligation to collect and protect the vital revenues of our county. I take my responsibility seriously, and I am dedicated to making this county great. Trinity County is dear to my heart, with the beautiful mountains and fresh air. I care deeply about the community and those that live here. I have the formal educational knowledge and the expert experience, which makes me the best choice for your treasurer tax collector. I look forward to serving you for the next 4 years. Thank you, everyone.
Stand up so you can see me, because I can't even see you. Yay! So, and I'm sorry about that. We probably should have been standing for you. I hope that you will choose me so that we can have true transparency, not just a word. We should have our accounts posted on the internet, because we have the internet now. We should have our reconciliations that are supposed to be done monthly and quarterly should be posted, so you know that both the auditor's office and the treasurer's office are matching their funds. We should take some of the investments we have and look at that, including the oversight committee. For instance, we have we have been invested in mutual funds since 1992, the same ones. One of the ones that we're invested in is a French company. We get 0.5% return, and they've been cited for excessive fees. They've been fined for it. Why are we invested with a French company since 1992? This is just basically same old, same old. We need an oversight committee so that we can beef up our financial liquidity. Another thing you need to ask yourselves, 10 years ago, 5 years ago, we only were getting $50 million in state and federal mandate funds. We had more deputies before, twice as many, with half as much money. Now we have a very small amount of deputies with over $100 million that we're receiving. I wonder where all that money is going, and I intend to find out if you trust me to do it. I hope that you'll vote for me and trust me. Thank you very much.
Okay, you're up.
One of the things about going to the Board of Supervisor meetings for 7 years, I have a strong perspective of what it's like to sit where you guys are sitting, to raise your hands and ask questions and not to get answers. And you can't answer everybody's questions, but there's a lot of legitimate ones. And to get a non-answer, because there's nothing you can do about it, when you contact the board and they don't respond to you, what are you going to do? As David Prentice, who's part of Prentice Long and Epperson, who's our now county council, told me during a public board meeting, if you don't like it, you can find satisfaction through the court system. That is not a way to run our government, and that's not a way to run our county. This is a government of the people, by the people, for the people. And I would like to make our government literally more honest, more open, more accessible. One thing that I bring to the board of supervisors that no one else has is my experience in the timber, fire, wildlife, fisheries. It was my schooling. It was my work. It's a huge part of our county, and it's been neglected, seriously neglected. There's a lot of things we can do, and I would like you to give me the opportunity to work for you and do what I can and help make Trinity great again. So I hope in June you remember me, Kate Graves, your supervisor. Thank you.
First off, thanks to the Lions for doing this, and thanks everybody for coming out and staying these hours listening to all this. I'm running again because we started something here 3 years ago, and we've been moving slowly, steadily forward and making Trinity Town a better place to live. There's a lot of inference about corruption and non-transparent, and quite frankly, it's not true. If you want to know about the budget, come to a budget hearing, read the budget book. It's all transparent. This is not secret government behind closed doors. But I want to come back to what I've accomplished in making Lewiston, or helping Lewiston make Lewiston a better place, making the North Lake a better place by working with people, getting projects started and accomplished, doing general plan work, doing all the infrastructure work that we have started, and a leader that has worked pretty hard looking out for your interests. The most honored thing in my life is being elected by you guys. And that's of all the things I've done in my life, it's a truly honor, and it's very humbling for me to be asked to look after your best interest. That's why I'm running, and please vote for me, Keith Groves.
Choice of three dedicated law enforcement officers for sheriff. We've all had the same post training, went to the same post academies, that's peace officers, standards, and training. We all have basic, intermediate, and advanced post certificates. We've all worked patrol, and that's where the similarities end. I've worked as a patrol sergeant, a patrol lieutenant, and a patrol commander. I've been in charge of two field area commands. I've worked in administrative assignments in two field divisions, as well as CHP headquarters and the state capitol. And some of those duties included statewide recruitment for the department and managing all the grants in the department for 2 years. I've been an instructor at the CHP Academy, CHP Coastal Division, Office of Traffic Safety conferences. Topics included commercial vehicle enforcement, sexual harassment, sex discrimination, Peace Officer Bill of Rights, civil liabilities, hate crimes, and racial profiling. I've completed first line supervisor, middle management, and command academies. I've also attended numerous other courses, including ethics and law enforcement, facilitators training, civil liability, police performance auditing, and the UC Davis executive management course. I feel I'm the best qualified candidate for the job. I performed the duties similar to a sheriff for several years as commander, and there is a steep learning curve if you've never had any administrative management or command experience. I spent over 30 years dedicated to public safety in California. Lived in Trinity County for 20 years, and we've raised our family here. Now's the time for new approaches, innovative ideas to address public safety. And my mission will be to protect everyone living, visiting, and traveling through Trinity County. So please consider voting for Tim Saxon for sheriff.
I'll keep it short. Tim's right, we're all three qualified, else we wouldn't be on the ballot. The differences lie in the path forward. And what I've, my experience over, like I said earlier, several different administrations and even more election cycles, I hear the same thing repeated over and over and over again. We keep trying the same thing and we're not getting anywhere, we're going downhill. So I and my opponents seem to wish to continue that same process. I offer you, I serve myself up to you as a change agent to do things differently. Thank you.
I just want to thank you all again for coming out tonight and hearing what we all have to say. Now, Trinity County is a small rural sheriff's office. And being a sheriff in a small department like this, you know, sometimes it's necessary for us to be part of what's going on, be part of what the deputies are doing. And I've got 21 years of being a deputy sheriff here. I can write search warrants. I can serve search warrants. I swing under a helicopter in the summers picking marijuana off the forest. You know, and that's, and I talked about it earlier, I want to be a proactive sheriff. Boots on the ground kind of a guy. Proactive with the sheriff's office, proactive with the department heads in our county. Department are proactive with the communities, because that's very important. You know, you guys are the ones that are going to elect me to be your sheriff. So I want to do what you guys would have me do as your sheriff, within reason, of course. But no, that's me. That's what I'm about. I want to. I'm an elected official for you people. So that's what I want to do, is be a sheriff for the people. Thank you.
So we heard a lot this evening about the functions of the CRA and some concerns about some of the duties, the way they're being carried out. What all this comes back to, I believe, is making the right choice. And you have a choice this election. And some of my goals for this election include, or for this office, excuse me, include examining all the processes and procedures to ensure that there's adherence to state and county code, reviewing customer service practices to ensure our citizens' concerns are addressed in a friendly and professional manner, establishing public outreach and involvement programs to leverage volunteers wherever possible. I know there's a lot of people that would like to get involved and haven't been able to. I'd like to ensure also that the deficiencies that were found by the grand jury and the Board of Equalization are addressed immediately and made public. I would like to examine the current practice of raising assessed values by 2% annually and look at ways we might better protect our fixed income individuals. Also analyzing the feasibility and public support for reopening polls in remote locations. I pledge to you to be a fair, honest, and transparent office holder who will abide by the law and whose approach to the public will be kind and helpful. I believe that you deserve an elected CRA who is committed to ensuring that your precious liberties are protected and the most important job in government, which is you, the citizen, and your right to vote, that is protected as well. These liberties also include property rights. Private property rights were some of the highest, held the highest by the founding fathers in our constitutional writings. So I really stand before you tonight offering you a choice, and I ask you to make the right choice on June 5th and vote for Lisa Wright. Thank you.
Here I am, Luke. So I'm going to keep this quick because I know everybody wants to get out of here. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight, getting to know your candidates, and voting for the right person that's for you. I also want to mention once again that I'm very proud of my team and the customer service that they provide to anybody who comes into the office. They're hardworking, knowledgeable individuals that make every attempt to ensure customers' needs are met. There's been many false allegations and statements tonight and that's going around. I hope I was able to clarify those for you, and if I wasn't, please contact me. I have my contact information on my campaign materials. I'm going to leave you with my 23 years with Trinity County, and most importantly, the last 8. Provide me the knowledge and experience that's essential to this position. I look forward to continuing serving you, and please vote for me on June 5th. Thank you.
Go to their office and explain issues and suggest solutions. That will enable me to be effective when, at representing our county when laws that affect our voting rights come up. I am also the youngest member on the California Eagle Forum Board of Directors, and I was also elected to help lead their election integrity committee. I will make a great elections officer because I love the electoral process. I want voter registration to be at an all-time high during my tenure. People need to participate in the electoral process because elections are the foundation of our republic, and without them, there will be no liberty. One of my goals are the registration of all high school students who are old enough to vote, and I hope to have an additional class so that they can learn about the electoral process and their rights as voters. I want to reopen our polling places because closing nearly all the polling places has added to the disenfranchisement of voters. I intend to follow the law which mandates that every voter receive a voter card that shows their name, address, and party affiliation so that each voter can be sure it is all correct. Another one of my goals is to train the personnel, both permanent and temporary, like poll and canvas workers, so that they are professional and follow the law. I plan to restructure each department so that it will run smoothly and competently, with the goal being to provide excellent service. So I want to leave you with this thought, that I have dedicated my entire adult life to community service, and I look forward to serving you.
Thank all of you for coming.
Thank you.